This is Duke University.
Good evening, and welcome to the 14th annual grand finale of the Duke Startup Challenge. Thank you so much. Thank you all for coming here tonight. My name is Janet Ng, and I'm joined tonight by Tingting Zhou, and we are your co-presidents of the Duke Startup Challenge this year, along with Naveed Samadani-McQuark and Caitlin Geis. Janet is a second year joint degree in the Nicholas School and the Fuqua School of Business. And Tingting Zhou is a senior at the Trinity College of Arts and Sciences. And for those of you who were here last year may remember, Tingting was actually the winner of last year's Duke Startup Challenge with her company, Nanoly. She loved the Duke Startup Challenge so much that she decided to come back and help organize this year. We're excited to be your MCs for the evening. We have a great show lined up for you tonight. We'll be hearing from 10 semi-finalists, a great keynote speaker, as well as our three finalists, one of whom will walk away tonight with $50,000. Is that we can't hear you? We still can't hear you. Does everyone know how to use the thunder sticks? We haven't heard yet? That's awesome. A little bit better. Cool. Before we get started, I just want to share what some people have been saying about the Duke Startup Challenge this year. A lot of the participants have been giving us a lot of feedback. They said, my interest in entrepreneurship was really sparked by this competition, and this has truly been an amazing experience. Some of our judges have said, this is a great mentorship opportunity for us judges to connect with startups. A lot of these judges are Duke alums, so it's really great for them to connect back with the Duke student body. And there are a lot of great ideas, which made judging pretty tough. And just to get you a sense of how incredible it is that the finalists are here tonight, we started with 127 teams from all over campus. And these 127 teams then went to 30 teams in round two, then to 13 semifinalists, the ones that will be pitching tonight, and then finally three finalists who will be giving their investor pitches. The first round, all they had to do was submit an idea summary. And our over 500 judges looked at these idea summaries to see who would advance to the second round. In the second round, we asked them to create angel list profiles, pitch videos, and a full business plan. All the 127 teams competed in various tracks. So we had the five functional tracks with prizes each, and then we had special interest tracks like the AARP Foundation, if a team was led by an undergraduate student or by a woman. And of course, we also had participants who advanced from our fall elevator pitch competition. Okay. So we're going to kick off the evening by first hearing from our 10 semifinalists. As Tingting just mentioned, this competition was really, really tough and fierce. So for them to be here today is a really great accomplishment in itself. So let's first welcome Fish Cycle.
All right. So every year, there are 1.3 million tons of fish waste created in Alaska. Much of it is dumped back into the ocean. On the other side of the earth, China is in great need of quality raw materials to make fish oil and animal feed. Fish Cycle is here to address this issue. We provide the missing link between Alaska and China. We have the lowest cost in the industry because we can import dry fish waste into China at zero custom tariff, which other companies can't. We have the most energy efficient equipment, and we have patented technologies. We'll all compete our Chinese counterparts because due to our sheer size and stable supply and high omega-3 content in our fish oil. We'll also be partnering with key players in the industry. And if nothing else, you should invest in the people here, the two founders whose last names rhyme. We know we'll be successful financially, and we cordially invite you to be part of Fish Cycle. Thank you, and everyone have fun tonight.
Thank you so much. So next up, we have Go Pinion.
How often are businesses asking for your feedback, whether by comment cards, emailed surveys, or sweepstakes at the bottoms of receipts? How often do you actually respond to them? Feedback is really, really low. The rates of return are tiny, and most of these surveys end up in the trash. At GoPinion, we aim to fix that problem. GoPinion is a web and mobile-based application that aims to give businesses private feedback from their customers. How will we get customers to give their feedback? The answer is the patented micro-survey format. It takes 15 seconds to fill out. It's all yes-no questions. And every single survey submitted gets a reward. Every survey that's filled out goes onto the business dashboard so businesses get real-time information about how they're performing. Our tiered pricing model allows any size business to implement GoPinion. They can even get it for free. At GoPinion, we believe in rewarding feedback.
Can you do it without your slides? Okay.
Okay, we don't have the slides, so. I mean, they don't have the slides. Okay, so I'm just gonna imagine that there are slides. Hopefully you understand by my hand gestures. Okay, so we are Job Opportunity. We are online personal assistant for your job search. So last year, my co-founder Amy and I were looking for jobs, and there was this enormous amount of information that we had to keep track of. We actually felt like people who are trying to pull their hair out and almost going bald in the process. We were trying to build a system that will help job seekers organize their job search together. We started off with an Excel file, but as you imagine, as we added more companies and more contacts, Excel files just became too heavy, too bulky to manually update it. That's where Job Opportunity was born. Job Opportunity is a web platform that not only brings all your job-related information at one place, but it also provides you a lot of tools that makes your job search process easy. We are LinkedIn integrated, which provides you an easy access to your professional network, and we have email plugins that will automate all your reminders for your contacts and jobs. So think of Job Opportunity as your CRM tool that is specifically tailored for your job search. So next time you're looking for jobs, just make sure you check out jobopportunity.com. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sarah from Judith and James, and we are an ethical apparel manufacturing company that empowers Kenyan women by paying them a fair wage. Consumers in the US want ethical products. You can see this in the demand for brands like Tom's Shoes or in the public outcry over a brand like Walmart or Nike's use of sweatshop labor. However, there simply are not enough ethical manufacturers out there to fill this rise in demand. And that's where Judith and James comes in. We have 15 women, all single mothers, who we have trained as seamstresses who are ready to go in production for our first client, a project runway designer. Our typical employee has 3 children who she will be able to educate and provide for with the wages that she earns at Judith and James. And this is why we are so excited about what we're doing. We believe that we can make money and make a difference. I'd love to answer any questions you have after the event, so come find me. Thank you.
Each year, 2 million occurrences of surgical site infections occur, leading to 100,000 deaths in the US alone. Complications from these infections can cost up to $100,000 for each instance. However, Medicare deems these infections to be never events. Therefore, hospitals would be solely responsible for covering these costs. Out of the 1 million hip and knee replacement surgeries that occur each year, 2% or 20,000 surgeries result in surgical site infections. Therefore, forcing hospitals to pay a weighted average of an additional $2,000 for each hip and knee replacement surgery. Luxana Biomedical is founded on the idea that the combination of germicidal ultraviolet C light and currently used pulsatile lavage technology could lead to a revolutionary reduction in surgical site infections. The combination of these two technologies in a small disposable device provides a cost-effective and easily applicable solution to combat the problem of surgical site infections. Thank you.
Next, we have Maddie T.
Before getting here today, you spent the day at school, at work. And throughout the day, you wanted something healthy, refreshing, energizing to drink. Not just today, but every day. Not Luxano, every day. Okay. Every day you're forced to compromise because of these choices, these suboptimal choices. Monty's different. We're basically a healthy, refreshing, caffeinated drink. It's an energizing, honest tea meets Izzy. Our customers are 9 different employers. We have hundreds of employees drinking Mati now. And in December, we won a Best Beverage Award at a national festival, beating out competitors like Arizona Tea. Yeah, that's there. We've gotten such great feedback from our customers that they're demanding bottles, and we're working with distributors to bring bottled Mati to customers across the US come August. Please try some at the end of the pitches, and thank you for supporting Duke Entrepreneurship.
Next we have NeuroSpire.
Hi. So neuromarketing is a new way of testing advertisements and other media. Electrodes record the brainwaves of consumers, and this data is used to measure their subconscious emotional responses. It's already used by thousands of companies that spend hundreds of millions of dollars on neuromarketing research. But there's a problem. The typical study will cost $50,000 and can take 6 weeks or more to conduct. NeuroSpire has a solution. Our software platform cuts costs and timing by 90% to $5,000 in 5 days, all the while delivering these incredible insights. In only 6 short months, we've acquired customers in over 20 countries, amassed 52,000 in sales, and have contracts signed worth more than $400,000 over the next 2 years. From cheese manufacturers in Kazakhstan to pizza chains in Canada, NeuroSpire is bringing neuromarketing to the world. Thank you.
So the next competitor is Smart Metals. Unfortunately, they're not able to be here tonight, but they have a video they'd like to show everyone.
Smart Metals solves the problem of e-waste disposal on college campuses by linking students up with local recycling facilities via our three-sided web service. How do we make money? Smart Metals works with students so that during pickup drives, students can literally walk outside their dorm rooms and apartments and throw away their unwanted electronic waste into boxes provided by the partnering local recycling facility. But Smart Metals doesn't charge for the web service. We don't charge for the offline organizational efforts. The only catch to use our services is on the part of the local recycling facilities. They agree to sell all university source e-scrap to us after that waste has been processed and is able to be sold to end product producers domestically or overseas. Smart Metals has already been gaining some traction since our establishment in January 2013. We've been turning a monthly positive net income since February 2013. Gotten very positive media coverage from industry-respected journalists such as Recycling International, and we'll be continuing our efforts to incentivize a sustainable future in the coming year. We hope that we'll have your support doing so.
So unfortunately, Stuntworks can't be here either, so we're gonna move forward to venture farming.
Howdy everyone, my name is Jack, and I'm a beginning farmer. For the last 2 years, I've worked as a farmhand making pennies. And soon, I hope to run my own farming operation. But the thing is, to move from farmhand to farmer entrepreneur, I need access to land, equipment, and support. But there aren't many options for me. Any suggestions?
Jack, I have an idea.
Oh! All right.
Hi, my name's Dave. I'm a co-founder of Venture Farming, which is a for-profit farm incubator for beginning organic farmers. We co-locate you and other young farmers on a single property. In exchange for a lease fee, we provide access to land and the support you need to get off your feet.
All right, so it sounds pretty good, but can I make a decent living?
Yes, definitely. Through the venture farming process, you have higher upside and lower risk. When you make money, we make money.
All right.
After 2 to 3 years in the program, you have the experience, confidence, and credibility to strike out on your own. So are you interested?
Yeah, let's do it, huh? Woo! All right. Yes.
Let's give one more round of applause to the semifinalists and their elevator pitchers. Before we hear from our keynote speaker, I want to just introduce some other prizes that our teams won. First, Refrackt won the clean energy track. Actually, we have us with here tonight, Richard Newell, the director of Duke's Energy Initiative, who will say a few words.
Thanks so much. In addition to being really happy to sponsor the Clean Energy Prize, more importantly, I just want to highlight, as you see here, a number of special tracks within the Duke Startup Challenge that highlight areas of real societal importance, like the Energy Prize, like the Women's Track, Social Enterprises, the AARP Prize for low-income seniors. And I want to highlight that in addition to the broad portfolio of things that the Duke Startup Challenge is supporting to startups in, there's some special targeted areas that we can really feel proud of. So thanks a lot.
Thank you. And just to announce the rest, Camras Vision won the Women-Led Startup Track. Mati T won the Undergrad-led and the Social Enterprise track. Agility for Life won the AARP Foundation Prize. And Wastewater and Sewer Solutions won the Alumni, Faculty, and Staff. Robert is actually with us tonight. He's with Wastewater and Sewer Solutions, so we're going to hear from him.
Hi, I'm Robert Ross from Wastewater and Sewer Solutions. We're the number one company for the number two problem. There's seven... There's 740,000 miles of public sewer lines and 500,000 of private sewer lines in the U.S. Each year, there are up to 600 million in damages stemming from fats, oils, and greases in our lines. We have a product to solve this problem. It's a combination of biosurfactants, enzymes, and microbes. The product dissolves the fog, keeps it from reforming, and forms a biobarrier on the inside of the pipes, keeping them clean for up to 6 months. Our product has been tested, proven, and sold. Washington, D.C. Sewer Authority has bought thousands of gallons of the product, and we're in talks with them for them to purchase much, much more. We're raising $375,000 to fund marketing, sales, and other operating expenses. If you're interested, please contact me.
And now I'm excited to introduce our keynote speaker. With us tonight is David Cummings. He's a 2002 Duke grad, and he's been an entrepreneur ever since he was an undergrad. In his senior year, he started a web content management company called Hannon Hill. And Hannon Hill actually went on to be recognized as one of the top fastest growing tech companies by Inc. 500. You know, while he was doing this, he was also starting other companies. You may have heard of Pardot. It's just sold for $100 million, and it's also been recognized by Inc. 500. We're really excited to have David with us tonight.
Thank you. So I'm super excited to be here tonight. Way back in 1998 was my first semester freshman year at Duke. And I was part of the first program that did Focus. Did anybody go through the Focus program? Any undergrads out there? So back in 98, we're just warming up. We're just getting the dot-com heyday going. And so as a high school senior, I was really excited about computers and technology and software. In the eighth grade, I was on a traveling baseball team, and a friend of mine gave me a book, Teach Yourself C in 21 Days. And so I took that book and I devoured it. I was really looking for ways to control and program the computer. So naturally, as an eighth grader, I wrote software to solve my algebra problems. The next step after writing some code to solve my own problem, I started thinking about what are some other products that I can write. So in the ninth grade, I started writing a software product called Statbook. And Statbook made it really easy for baseball coaches to manage and track the statistics from their baseball team. After Statbook in the 10th grade, I started writing a startup series. So every time the Windows 3.1 program booted up with your computer, it would have a new Bible verse of the day, a new vocabulary word of the day, a famous quote, an SAT prep word. And so I sold a few thousand dollars worth of this Windows 3.11 shareware application in the late 90s. So I was hooked on this computer thing. I was hooked on writing software to solve problems, to make products. So fast forward another year, I write my senior high school college admission essay all about how I want to be a software entrepreneur for the rest of my life. Since the eighth grade, I knew exactly what I wanted to do, and I believed that Duke would be a great place for me to start my education and then go on and be a software entrepreneur. So freshman year at Duke, I was in the Focus program, and I was in the Computers in Society Focus program. And so this one was pretty interesting in that we were housed in Blackwell on East Campus. And at the time, believe it or not, only three of the freshman dorms on East Campus had air conditioning. So we had the Computers in Society. There was about 30 of us in an air-conditioned dorm. Well, back in 1998, you know who else they put inside of air-conditioned dorms? All the football players. So we had all the big football players and all the geeky nerds in the same air-conditioned dorm on East Campus. And so first semester freshman year, there was a professor of mine. His name was Frank Borchardt. So Frank taught an instructional technologies class as part of the Focus program. Now, Frank was an eccentric character. He was a full professor of Germanic languages, but he had become famous using instructional technologies for foreign language learning. Early in his career, he had decided that as soon as he got full professorship, he was never going to cut his hair again. So he had a long beard, really long ponytail. He wore all black all the time, and he had a much larger-than-life personality, a laugh that would fill up this entire room. So at the end of my first semester freshman year course, Frank said, you know, if you ever want to start a company, come see me. So I didn't think too much about it. I put it in my back pocket. Fast forward a couple years to my junior year, I was getting kind of bored with the academic stuff. You know, I had done a variety of programs on campus. I was the president of the club golf team. I was the vice president of the Duke Business Club. I was in student council. I was in Wayne Manor. But I really loved entrepreneurship. I was constantly starting little businesses. Freshman year, my roommate and I, we put together a little site called textbooks.ml.org, which was the first textbook exchange marketplace. After putting the site up, we got some good buzz on campus, and I promptly got summoned by the manager of the Duke bookstore to come in and talk about how their business operates and why they charge the prices they charge for used textbooks. So I thought, obviously it's a pain point here or a sore point if I'm getting summoned by the manager. I went on and I wrote another little web app called The Devil Community. And it was basically an unofficial message board and place to gossip about the Duke community. One of the things that I did inside the software is I put up a professor and course evaluation review module. So all the students could go in and rate their professors. And boy, the professors were not happy. I promptly got an email from Dean Sue to come see her at her office. Has anybody ever been to Dean Sue's office, Office of Student Affairs? So Dean Sue brought me in, and she talked about the website and talked about how the professors were unhappy. And at the end of the day, I was like, it's free speech. We're not doing anything that has any libel or slander. And so it was a very cordial meeting, and I got to say I got to go to Dean Sue's office, and nothing much came of it. So by my junior year at Duke, I was really ready to do something serious. So in January of 2001, I decided to take a leave of absence the next semester and work full-time on my first real idea. So my first real idea came out of building websites for organizations at Duke. So I built sites for a couple different sororities, several professors, for the Duke Psychology Department, for the Duke Computer Science Department, for Welcome Baby, a local nonprofit in Durham. And so I built all these websites, and I would turn it over to the person that had asked me to build the site, and they'd say, wow, this looks great. I love it. Now, how do I change it? And so after hearing that question a dozen times, how do I change it, the proverbial light bulb went off, and I knew it was time to build a product. So in January of 2001, I rented a room in the Couch Building on 9th Street, $300 a month. I got a little interior room, 12 feet by 12 feet, no exterior windows, and I put a sign above the door that said profit, and profit was spelled P-R-O-P-H-E-T. So on 9th Street, I started working basically full-time. Truth be told, my grades slipped considerably by my junior year. Freshman year, I was on the dean's list. Junior year, not even close. I was working full-time on my first serious company, Hannon Hill. So January 2001 started. February 2001, get an off-campus office. And then I went back to visit the professor that I'd had freshman year, Frank Borchardt. And I said, Frank, I have this idea for software that's going to make it as easy to update a website as it is to do your email in a web browser. So if you have the skills to use Hotmail, you have the skills to maintain your website. He said, great, I'll write a check. And there on the spot, he committed $20,000 for me to hire four of my classmates as summer interns at $10 an hour to write code building our first product, Super Update. So he wrote the check, deposited the money, recruited some friends of mine. We spent the summer writing code. We launched the product. Very modest success. We found a publicly traded company out of Texas that wanted to license it. We licensed the product to them, used that money to build a new product, and that new product we built is called Cascade Server. So fast forward a couple more years. It's April 15th, 2003, so tax day. We have this new product called Cascade Server, which is a mid-market version of the content management system. We launched it at the Internet World Show in San Jose. The product wins the award for the best of show. So they had different categories, and it won the award for the best new product at the show. I thought, wow, this is great. The analysts love our product. And so we went back to Atlanta, kept working on the product, just waiting for the phone to ring, just waiting for the orders to pull in, and nothing happened. So what I want to do tonight is take you through 8 different lessons learned. Lesson number 8, starting with the Hannon Hill experience, and then the next 7 lessons coming from the Pardot experience. So we launched this product. Cascade Server launched on April 15, 2003. By April 15, 2004, we only had 2 paying customers, and I realized that the field of dreams was not going to work. I wasn't going to be able to just build it, and they would come. So then I put a different hat on, and I said, I got to unwind the product management, the engineering, the love of writing code, and for us to be successful, I personally need to become very good at sales and marketing. The best products don't win unless they have the best marketing. Just go ask Microsoft. Version 1.0 or 2.0 of a Microsoft product usually is very inferior, but by version 3.0 and the marketing, we've seen it many times how successful Microsoft's been. So I didn't learn that lesson until Cascade Server, Hannon Hill, the year 2004. So I did what any aspiring, scrappy entrepreneur would do. I hired more interns. So in Atlanta, I put an ad out on the Emory website, and I hired two Emory students to be cold callers 20 hours a week. I went over to the local Barnes & Noble. I got one of those really thick books, the 4,160 two-year, four-year public and private schools in North America, the place that anybody would start when they wanted to sell something. Tore the book in half, gave half to one intern, half to the other intern, and all they did is cold called all of the directors of IT, VPs of IT, VPs of university relations, directors of campus communications, anybody that would be involved in a web or internet or communications committee on campus. The cold calling proved to be phenomenally successful. 2004, we sold 9 copies of the software to universities. 2005, we sold 15. 2006, we sold 30. 2007, we sold 50. Now today, Hannon Hill is the number one provider of web content management software to universities. Over 200 colleges and universities use the Hannon Hill software. So 2007 arrives, I see the universities adopting the software, but I also see the writing on the wall that the market's being encroached on by the big guys up top. So a lot of consolidation had occurred. FileNet had been acquired, Interwoven had been acquired, Stellant had been acquired, OpenText was gobbling them up, and different big companies were taking these high-end tools, bringing them into the fold, and then selling them with their 1,000-person-plus sales teams. At the low end of the market, you had the rise of all the open-source content management systems, like Joomla and WordPress and Drupal. So I saw the writing on the wall that this market was going to rapidly consolidate. We had a really strong niche in the higher education market, and so it was time to find something new. So, late 2006, had this idea for marketing software to make it easy for companies to generate leads online. So, sort of like a LendingTree.com. And so I recruited a classmate of mine from Duke, and by March of 2007, I had stopped working completely on the first business. He had come on full time, and we started Pardot. Now, Pardot is such an extravagant, wonderful name. People love to say, where did the name come from? So in December of 2006, I went on to dictionary.com, like any good entrepreneur would do, and I typed in the word marketing. And at the time, dictionary.com returned the translation of the word that you typed in addition to the definition. So it returned 29 different translations of the word marketing. Well, the 27th translation, in case anybody is interested, is the Latvian verb to market or to sell, and it's the word Pardot. So Pardot, a 6-letter domain name, I quickly went over to GoDaddy.com, looked to see if it was available. It was. And so I paid my $8, and I bought the domain name Pardot. So March 2007, we start working full-time on Pardot, and the goal is to make it really easy for B2B marketers to generate and nurture leads online in an automated, analytical fashion. So what does all that jargon mean? It means that we send lots of emails, and we make great landing pages, and we track all their different digital fingerprints that are left. So you visit a web page, that's a digital fingerprint. You download a white paper or a free trial, that's a fingerprint. So we built software to solve a problem that Hannon Hill had. So me running the content management software company, I would realize that marketing could be so much more sophisticated if it was built for a B2B marketer. All the tools at the time were focused on the B2C marketer. So it was Constant Contact and Google Analytics. But for the B2B marketer, there wasn't a B2B equivalent of that software. 2007 actually proved to be the right time to start the company 7 years prior, several of our competitors had started already, companies like Active Conversion, companies like Manticore Technology. And what had happened is that they had started in a good market too early. And in my book, if you have the right idea, even if you're too early, it's a failure. Right when we started, there was another company that started at the same time, Marketo. And a few years prior, another company led by a Duke grad called Eloqua was also in the same market. So the big takeaway, and I didn't know it at the time, was that our timing was impeccable. If we had been 3 or 4 years too early, we would have had fatigue, we wouldn't have had a platform, we wouldn't have had a strong customer base. And if we would have been 2 or 3 years after we started Pardot, the market would have already left us. There was a total greenfield opportunity, and the market timing would have been too late. So 2007, perfect timing, had no idea at the time, it was complete dumb luck. But in retrospect, timing is much more important than I ever gave it credit for. All right, lesson number 6. So anyone in the audience have heard of a company called HubSpot? Anybody heard of Marketo? Anybody heard of Eloqua? Anybody heard of Genius.com? So those companies have raised $300 million from venture capitalists. $300 million. And so little old Pardot in Atlanta, we didn't raise any money, we had no board of directors, we had no investors. Little old Pardot in Atlanta was competing with HubSpot, which has raised $103 million, competing with Marketo, which had raised $107 million, competing with Eloqua, which had raised $45 million, competing with Genius.com, which had raised $60 million. So we had these extremely heavily funded competitors, yet Pardot won the majority of the deals in which we competed against one of the competitors. So our ability to focus on the small to mid-sized segment of the market, our ability to offer amazing customer service, our ability to do the sales process using a complete inside sales team. So as a business, we were laser focused on companies between 20 and 200 total employees, of which 5 to 50 of those employees are in sales and marketing with at least one full-time marketing manager on staff, and they had to have bought Google AdWords, and they had to have an email newsletter sign-up box on their website, and they had to have salespeople listed in LinkedIn. So companies that had all of those criteria were unbelievable candidates for our software. So we were laser-focused on that segment of the market, that small to mid-sized segment of the market, and we didn't build the most features, but we built the best features for our segment of the market. So the company with the most money doesn't always win. So, small, not venture-backed company in Atlanta, competing with heavily funded companies based out of Boston and Silicon Valley, one of the things that we had to do an amazing job of was embracing our constraints. So I liken it to what Toyota did with the Prius. So when Toyota set out to build the Prius, their goal was to build a 50 mile per gallon hybrid that could be sold to the American middle class for $21,000 and could seat 4 people. So that $21,000 price point, that was the constraint that they focused on, and everything about their business, everything about that new product development had that same focus. So for Pardot, we looked out into the market, our SMB segment, 20 to 200 people, 5 to 50 sales and marketing, so on and so forth. We decided to price our product at the most amount of money that we could get a mid-level marketing manager to put it on his or her credit card without having to get any sign-off from finance. That's how we priced the product. It wasn't based on cost of goods sold. It wasn't based on how much it cost us to make it. We priced the product based on the most we could charge to that type of person while having the shortest sales cycle possible. So that price point, $1,000 per month. So in the Pardot business, we had mid-level marketing managers paying us $1,000 a month, and we averaged a 40-day sales cycle, and we did 100% of the sales over the phone and over the web. So we had an unbelievable customer acquisition process and extremely focused on our segment of the market. We embraced our constraint of $1,000 a month. We sold over the phone, we serviced over the phone, we trained over the phone, we supported over the phone, but we did it with unbelievable class and white glove service. So our customer service was known throughout the industry as the best customer service. Another thing that we did a really good job at was listening to customers. Everybody's heard of the proverbial telephone game. You say a sentence that's got 20 words to the person next to you, they repeat the sentence to the next person next to them, and it goes around the room, and after a dozen people, it comes back to you, and it's nothing like what you originally said to the person next to you. Well, the same thing happens day in and day out in all industries, in all verticals. One of the things that we did a really good job at is staying close to the customer on the front line, but also doing a great job at listening to the customers of our main competitors. So we would listen to the customers of our main competitors by things like Twitter, things like LinkedIn groups, which are an amazing resource, things like Facebook and blogs and message boards. So we were staying as close as possible to our own customers while also listening to the customers of our main competitors using a variety of online tools. And so again, not having any venture backing, not having any institutional money, we had to make the best features, not the most features. So we would listen to our competitors' customers and use that information to make better decisions for our own product. Another really important lesson learned. In the Hand and Hill business, content management software to universities is really important. They pay good money for it. Hand and Hill has sold over $10 million worth of its software to universities, so there's some value there somewhere. But whenever a university or a college would say, what's the return on investment? We never had a good answer. They would say, how do I value this? How do I sell my board that I want to spend $60,000 on your product? And so we would talk about consistency of look and feel. We'd talk about training the people on campus so they could do it without any IT involvement. But it was very much in between a vitamin and a painkiller. Pardot was an unbelievably different experience. Pardot was a painkiller from day one. Our first customer that we put the product in their hands, it was a call center training company. A week after they had the product, their salesperson told us that they literally didn't know how they did their job before they started using the Pardot software. And so when someone comes in and tells you that their whole world, the way they spend their 40 hours a week, changes completely because of your product, you know you're onto something really special. So with the Pardot software, we would go in there. 30 to 60 days later, they'd have it up and running. And within 30 days after that, they would have a complete 100% return on investment of the product. And by the end of the first year, the average customer would receive 10 times the investment in the software. So it literally changed the way sales and marketing operated. Marketing suddenly had tremendous credibility. They could show every single dollar being spent online, every single click. They would define what a marketing qualified lead looked like. The sales teams would say, here's what a sales qualified lead looked like. The handoff was elegant and automated. And so sales and marketing started talking. Marketing started becoming much more effective, and sales started closing more deals with a shorter sales cycle. It truly changed the way sales and marketing works for companies with a complex sale and online marketing. Another interesting thing occurred during the process. The more successful Pardot became, the easier it was to be distracted. Now you think, oh, I'm going and I'm trying a few different things, and once we find something that works, we're just going to double down on it. The typical entrepreneur mentality. Let's go start three companies and maybe one will work and we'll focus on that. Well, the thing they don't tell you is that when your company becomes more and more successful, more people want your time, more people want to partner with you, more people want to license your software or some module of your software to be embedded in their product, more people want to take your software to different geographic markets, different languages. The number of distractions actually increases the more successful your company becomes. From a Pardot perspective, we stayed completely focused on selling directly to the customer, and we made sure that everything we did, we could control our own destiny. A lot of people talk about entrepreneurship as being risky. They're like, oh my gosh, you took a risk, you started your company. I view entrepreneurship as not risky because I'm a control freak and I want to control my own destiny. And I believe the best way that I can do that is by having my own company. So the more successful you become, the more people will want your time and the easier it is to lose focus at what's working. So the final takeaway for tonight, if you leave this room and you only remember one thing, it's that the most important thing you can do as an entrepreneur is build the best culture possible. Your corporate culture is the only sustainable competitive advantage that's completely within your control. You can't control the government. You can't control your competitors. You can't control the markets, the economy. The only thing that you can control day in and day out is who you work with, who's on your team, who you sit next to and fight the battles with. So culture is the most important thing. At Pardot, we kept it really, really simple. Our mantra, be the best place to work and be the best place to be a customer. The best place to work, the best place to be a customer. Using those two things, it creates a lens for every decision that we ever made. We knew immediately what the right decision was based on those two items. Best place to work, best place to be a customer. We then broke it down. We said we want to be a place that's good work, good people, good pay. Good work defined as work that's challenging, interesting, and stimulating. Good people defined as people who are positive, self-starting, and supportive. And good pay defined as pay that's above average salary with benefits in the 99th percentile. So we had unbelievable benefits. The benefits were an outward manifestation of the fact that we were a people-centric business. So what were some of the benefits that we did? For all 105 employees of mine, I paid for 4 hours of house cleaning every month, fully administered and delivered by the company. So you would literally go online, book an online appointment, and we would actually send a housekeeper to your house for 4 hours a month to take care of their home. We had a very simple vacation policy at Pardot. It was two single words, be reasonable. So we had no vacation time, no flex time, no sick time. It was a results-only work environment. So every single position in the company, from the receptionist to the executives, knew their exact roles and responsibilities, and they could work anywhere, anytime, on their own schedule. We paid for 100% of health, 100% of dental, 100% of short-term disability, long-term disability. We had catered breakfast 5 days a week, catered lunch every Monday. And we even took one of our conference rooms, turned it into a spa, and hired a full-time on-site masseuse, a full-time W-2 employee that all she did was give massages to our staff as her full-time job. Everybody was guaranteed 15 minutes a week, and a lot of people got 30 minutes a week. So unbelievable benefits. Pardot was in business for 5.5 years, from cold start, March of 2007, to exit, October of 2012. And in those 5.5 years, only 6 people in total voluntarily left the business. So only 6 people in 5.5 years with over 100 employees ever left by their own initiative. The Atlanta Journal-Constitution named Pardot the number one best place to work in all of Atlanta in 2012 in the summer. And then in October of 2012, Exact Target bought the business for $100 million. Questions?
So you said one of the most important things is time. How do you know when the time is right?
That's a really hard question. So the question is, timing is important, but how do you know when it's the right time? And I don't have an answer for you. The best thing that I can say is to get rid of all distractions, all other business ideas, and focus all of your energy on one single idea. The challenge that I see is that entrepreneurs go and they work on 2 or 3 things in parallel, such that they never get enough traction to know whether they have a good idea or not, and it often dies on the vine. So double down and go really deep on one single thing. So we had a crazy recruiting process. The question was on the culture side, what was our recruiting process like to scale up to north of 100 people, yet to keep the culture as strong as it was on day one? One of the things that we did is we made all employees in all positions write a 2-page essay. So it was 5 short answer questions. We set up 3 different culture check teams. So we had 2-person teams of people that best embodied our values, and they were the second to last step in the interview process. And so all they did is interviewed the person for an hour for culture fit. And then my co-founder and I interviewed every single candidate. So we were the final step in the interview process, and it was required unanimous. So if anybody in the process said no, including the receptionist and how the candidate treated him or her at time in the reception, anybody could veto the candidate, no questions asked.
What are you focusing on now?
So I have a new software company called Kevi that's doing cloud middleware, making it easy to connect different cloud-based applications. And I bought a 100,000 square foot building in the middle of Buckhead in Atlanta, and I'm in the process of building the largest tech entrepreneurship center in the Southeast. Any other questions?
Do you think that technology should learn something about computer programming? Should be mandatory for anyone wants to be an entrepreneur?
So the question was, should they learn technology if they want to be a web entrepreneur? So absolutely, if they want to do anything related to technology or software, I do believe they should learn enough programming to be dangerous, not to make a career out of it, but so that they can be a better manager and leader and a more effective contributor for the team. So absolutely, learn Ruby on Rails if you're thinking about being a web entrepreneur.
I haven't started your question yet.
So the professor,
am I saying the question again?
So the question was, what kind of return did the professor get? So the professor invested the money in 2001. I paid him back all his money and doubled it in 2005. And then in 2006, he passed away. So he got double his money back and had more fun than the markets, especially during that period of the economic cycle.
When is the most difficult time you get over in the 10-year entrepreneurial experience? One thing, most difficult.
At one point, I had $50,000 worth of credit card debt, so I wouldn't recommend that. That was very stressful. One time, the business wasn't going well, and we had to fire five people, which was a horrible experience, but it was the right thing, and the company was a lot more successful because of it. But as an entrepreneur, the worst thing to do is have to fire somebody, in my experience.
Can you talk a little bit more about the exit process and your thought process there?
Sure, so the exit process, more thoughts. The company was never built to be sold. Our goal was to build the best business possible, creating the best place to work. So in June of 2012, we were approached by ExactTarget. We did a couple little dog and pony shows for them, showed them the software. They really liked it. They invited us on site to Indianapolis in mid-July. And then mid-August, they sent us a term sheet. It was the proverbial initial offer type phase. From a business point of view, at that point, once it got a little bit hot and heavy, we said, our goal as entrepreneurs is to sell the business for $100 million. So your offer is not anywhere close, but if you want to pay $100 million for it, we're all ears. And so we kept saying no, they kept raising their offer, we kept saying no, they kept raising their offer, and then finally they said, okay, you guys win, we'll pay you what you want. So we were in a good position that we had no investors. We had no timeline on the business. We had nobody saying, I need to return money to my LPs. And so it worked out really well that we could control our own destiny, and the right acquirer came on, came around at the right time at the right price.
Can you talk about growing and starting a tech company in the Southeast and what that was like the time you did it and what that's like now?
Sure, so growing a startup company in the Southeast is awesome, especially in a Raleigh-Durham area or an Atlanta area. Tons of great technical talent at Georgia Tech and at Duke and NC State. Really good low cost of living. You're not wrapped up in the Silicon Valley hype machine. You're forced to be scrappy from the get-go. So you're not, you know, nobody's running around throwing out million-dollar seed round checks to you. So from the Southeast perspective, I actually think it's the best place in the country to bootstrap or to be really capital light for a tech startup. Boston's crazy expensive, Silicon Valley's even more expensive. The Southeast has talent, has low cost of living, has great lifestyle, great schools. So I'm a big proponent of doing it in the Southeast. I think we have time for one more question.
What's your take on venture capitalists?
I think venture capitalists are great, but 99.99% of companies should not raise venture money. Venture money is only good if you're building the next eBay. If you're building a business that has extreme network effects or marketplace effects, if you're building a business that has a dramatic greenfield where it's going to be a winner take all, then I think it makes sense. But the majority of businesses don't have extreme network effects and are not monopolies or winner-take-all type markets. So one final announcement. In honor of Frank Borchardt, I've donated $500,000 to Duke to endow the Frank Borchardt Undergraduate Prize Fund. And the fund is going to grant $20,000 per year to the top undergrad entrepreneurs at Duke.
David Cummings, that was a great keynote, and what a wonderful thing that you've done to endow the Undergrad-led Track Prize. Now we're going to get into our finalist teams. Okay, so how this is going to work, each team will receive 8 minutes to pitch, and then there will be a 7-minute Q&A for the judges to ask the team's questions, and then the judges' vote will determine the winner. However, in the case of a tie, your vote, the audience's vote, will actually break the tie. So do stick around. We will explain audience choice voting after all the pitches have been heard. So do realize that your vote may determine the winner as well. Okay, I want to invite all the judges who are here tonight to join on the stage. These judges have traveled from various parts of the country and we're so excited to have them here with us tonight. Thank you to our judges. We're gonna get started with Camras Vision.
Thank you. So right now, our groundbreaking technology will be passed out to the judges. You can, unfortunately, I don't have one for every one of you. So you can take it out of the bag and look at it. Our prototypes are there. We're doing well so far. So I hope you think so too. Hello, my name is Lucinda Camras, founder and inventor at Camras Vision, and I'm here to talk to you about a devastating disease called glaucoma and how we at Camras Vision plan to stop its progression and save sight. Glaucoma is one of the leading causes of irreversible blindness. This affects 67 million people worldwide and 4 million people in the US alone. Even with all the treatments available today, people continue to go blind due to this disease. And once your vision is gone from glaucoma, it will never be restored. The only treatment in glaucoma therapy is to lower pressure in the eye. And you can divide this treatment into four segments. You have your drug only, your laser procedures, your incisional surgery, and your shunt. The choice of treatment is based off of the severity of your glaucoma, mild to advanced. What are the complication rates associated with each one of these treatments? And what's that target pressure range you hope to reach? Ophthalmologists enjoy surgery, but you can see that drugs hold the majority of the market. And this is because surgeries like shunts that achieve those lower pressures that you actually desire have a 30 to 40% complication rate, which means a third of your patients that come in are worse off because of it. And none of these treatments can even last for over 5 years. This is truly unacceptable. What we need to do is find that holy grail in glaucoma therapy, where we can achieve those lower pressures and actually be able to fine-tune the pressures to the needs of the patient for long-term patient care and stopping that glaucoma progression and blindness. We obviously need a lower complication rate as well. If you have that, you've opened up the market to treat mild to advanced glaucoma. Unfortunately, no therapy can do that. Well, until the camera shunt, until us. So, as I said before, those shunt procedures have an associated 30 to 40% complication rate. Now, this is mainly due to one reason, and this is their choice of drainage. They choose to drain in between tissues that have an aggressive wound healing response that leads to uncontrollable outcomes, complications, and unpredictable pressure gradients. So, my father, a world-renowned glaucoma specialist who actually developed the most effective drug in glaucoma therapy, and I said, well, let's design a new device that drains to a different area of the eye that doesn't have those complications associated. And now we have predictability. We can set pressures in the eye. And we also have a replaceable component that we can allow for adjustability to fine-tune that pressure to the needs of the patient for a long-term personalized care. And actually, that replaceable component can provide an additional revenue stream for the company. Lastly, the surgery is quick and simple, which further reduces that complication rate. Our goal is to make glaucoma surgery as clean of a procedure as cataract surgery. There is a reason why there are no drugs on the market to treat cataracts, And it is because their surgery is so safe and effective. We will do this for glaucoma therapy. Our preliminary studies have been very successful. We have done some in monkeys in which we showed feasibility and proof of concept of this drainage site. We also showed a superiority to an incisional surgery. We have ongoing studies now in rabbits, which have been quite successful thus far, and we have been funded by the NIH and NSF small business grants. Now you can look at our development plan as divided into four stages. We're currently in stage one, going quickly to stage two, where we do those long-term animal studies that we need for those IDE applications. Now, going from stage two to three is a big transition for our company. We need a CEO. We need to hire more people. This is when we're doing our first-in-man studies. Interestingly enough, based off of our recent grant success, this could be paid for by grant funding. Of course, we'll have to apply and see. And then there is the final stage. This is the big stage. This is our clinical trials. We'll enter Europe first. We plan to be CE marked by 2017. We'll have ongoing trials in the US going through the PMA route. We expect to be FDA approved by the end of 2018. We need a lot of capital to do this. And we also will need strategic partnerships to really make this effective. Right now, we're actually in a very difficult stage to raise funds. Winning Duke Startup Challenge would mean tremendous amount of funding for this company, or at least, well, tremendous to us, considering how much we've raised thus far. But we can get that 50K, that 50K will allow us to have that 50% matching from the NSF and allow us to do those long-term animal studies that will prepare us for that IDE application and increase the value of our company and attract those investors we need to get to that stage three, those first-in-man studies. Our goal is to be acquired when we've maximized the value of our company. We will do this by using a contract manufacturer and partnering with a distributor, one of the big ophthalmic firms, to sell our device. We will incentivize our distributor by offering a 60% discount on our $700 price device. This revenue model is based off of entering Europe first, and then the US when we have our FDA approval. Based off of doctor surveys, we expect to have high traction in the shunt markets first, and then have that being adopted in those other surgical markets. This model does not include the additional revenue stream from that replaceable component. It also doesn't address that drug-only market as well. So in fact, these are pretty modest estimates considering the technology's potential. We are a lean startup. My business partner, a Fuqua alum, is working for the company full-time. I will graduate with my PhD in biomedical engineering from Duke in May and be working for the company full-time. I have 10 years of experience in the glaucoma space and have worked with two different ophthalmic startups before, one in which I conducted some of their preclinical testing that led to their first initial funding. What we lack in experience, we've supplemented with seasoned advisors from the business side, the entrepreneurial side, and I'm so proud of our scientific advisory team, where they are really some of the world's leaders, and three of which have experience with getting a device through the FDA. In summary, glaucoma is a disease affecting millions of people who may go blind because their pressure is not adequately managed. Camras Vision has found the holy grail in glaucoma therapy. We now can provide precise pressure control, adjustability for long-term personalized care for the patients. It's a quick surgery. We'll have reduced complication rates. And now we can open up the market to treat all stages of glaucoma. This truly has worldwide implications. Help us save sight. Thank you.
you, Lucinda. We're now going to hear from our judges for up to 7 minutes of Q&A.
Good job. Very enthusiastic. And so I have a couple of questions.
Okay.
One, and I might have missed it on your slide,
okay. Yeah.
In terms of the costs compared to the competition, did I miss that?
Yeah, the pricing of the device. And that's something, I'll go back to the revenue slide. So that's something, shunts are usually marked between like $400 to $1,000. You know, this is actually subject to change. A part of this is based off of reimbursement and knowing of CPT codes. It's about, you know, $1,500 in terms of that CBT code covering the hospital time and also the shunt. So this, but this could change based off the potential, and because the surgery is shorter, you can actually have an increased revenue stream to the hospital, so we could potentially price this higher. But based off of our initial manufacturing costs, it only costs about, you know, $50 to $70 to actually make one of these devices. So
that's less than what they're paying today?
For making those, most shunts cost around that range,
okay,
to make. And in terms of what they sell it at, it's between that $400 to $1,000.
Okay. And then on the intellectual property,
uh-huh,
so it looks like you licensed the IP from someplace?
Yeah, to Camras Vision. So
from a university? Or?
So we have one issued patent, and it was actually, so my father was chairman of ophthalmology at University of Nebraska, uh-huh, and we actually gave rights to them, and then they gave us, me and my father, an exclusive license, and then we gave an exclusive license to Camras Vision. And then we have a continuation in part application that I submitted actually after my father had passed away. But that's owned by, you know, me, and that will be licensed to my company.
Okay.
excuse me, can you speak to the CPT codes or reimbursement issues?
So one of the things in terms of what questions have asked is how price sensitive are certain things when you go across this. I mean, shunts are covered. It's insurance that is paying for it. And doctors are paid with a different CPT code. So it's, there's a question of, you know, will doctors be incentivized to use one shunt versus another? And it may be the hospital might have some influence saying, you know, we get paid X amount for, you know, doing this procedure, and they may say, hey, we'd like you to use this device. But it really is the physician who chooses, you know, what sort of surgical approach they think is best for the patient.
Yeah. So I'll agree. I like your presentation.
Okay.
You obviously know your subject, and your plan was full of detail that shows how much work you guys have put into it. So great job for that.
Thank you.
So my question is about the competition,
uh-huh,
right?
Yeah.
So obviously there are other shunts in the market.
There are,
right?
Yes.
And one of the things you talked about in your plan was that your shunt reduces the surgery time by 75%. So how does that compare to the other shunts? Are they quick to install?
I'm happy you mentioned, well, this is comparing to other surgery, but I had a backup slide.
Okay.
So in terms of the other shunts, I mean, in terms of surgical time, it usually takes around an hour, 45 minutes to do this surgery, and it's about 10 minutes to do ours. So it's a significant reduction in time. We are making this more like cataract surgery. And I'm sorry, did you have another question besides the surgical time and the other sorts of advantages that
we
have?
Well, that was my first one. So your shunt takes 10 minutes and theirs takes an hour and a half.
An hour to 45 minutes to an hour.
A lot longer.
If it's a resident, maybe an hour and a half.
Okay. Well, so that's a good answer. And again, compliments on having the back. I mean, this is exactly what I was asking. So, because I'm most interested, you're not going to be in the market until 2018, right? These other shunts are in the market now. How is your patent going to protect your product from them?
Yeah. So, I think part of the protection, at least in ours, I mean, we do really have a novel drainage site that we're doing and a very novel device. And I think, there's a certain amount, patent can protect you, but you may have
people trying to get in that, but I think a lot of the way the culture is that they do incremental improvements on the technology to get it fast, to go through that 510K approach, and they haven't tried to do a big game changer. We're the ones who are trying to do the big game changer. I mean, this is kind of how you can look at all the other surgical treatments out there, and we really feel that, you know, especially those last three, the targeting pressure, adjustability, and I guess my slide got kind of cut off, but this sort of aspect is really key for preventing that vision loss, because if you can control the pressure, you can stop that death to the nerve, and that is key for helping patients.
One more question.
This is a very layperson question, but at this stage, given there's so many years until you're on the market, is there a percentage odds that you give,
to us getting out there?
Yeah, how likely is something like this to get through all those hurdles and make it?
I mean, medical device companies are hard. I mean, they say, you have a 10% success rate. But I feel like we have a certain amount of market traction. We already have people excited about what we're doing. My father had a presence in the community. I've given talks at ARVO as being the exciting new technology. We've published in textbooks. I really feel in my heart that we can stand it. We're that 10% that makes it. I really feel it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Great. Thank you, Camras Vision. We're going to move on to Refrackt.
Hi, my name is Dan Chab, and this is Judy Wing Lee, and today we're really excited to talk about our company, Refrackt. Refrackt is a mobile wastewater treatment service company that allows drillers to treat and reuse their wastewater on site. Best of all, our process is driven by waste heat that otherwise would disappear into the air. We're targeting the hydraulic fracturing wastewater treatment industry, which is expected to grow from $1 billion to $9 billion by 2020. The drivers behind that growth are three things. First, unconventional resources are overtaking conventional sources in the U.S., which is reshaping global geopolitics. Next, increasing regional water scarcity in the U.S. is jeopardizing the ability to use the hydrofracking process in many of the areas with key resources. And third, fracking uses a lot of water and produces a huge amount of wastewater. Currently, a lot of well drillers are trucking that wastewater off-site and injecting it deep underground in old oil and gas wells. However, outside of Texas, they're simply running out of wells to put that water into. In addition, there's been large questions about the health and the environmental safety of this method of disposal. Refrackt is the fracking industry's water solution, and Judy's going to talk a little bit about the technology that lies at the center of that solution. Judy?
Hi, I'm Judy. I worked in the industrial and water treatment industries at United Technologies and GE Mobile Water. And now I'm working on developing breakthrough technologies in water treatment. I'm going to tell you about Refrackt's water regeneration system and why it's such a great application for hydraulic fracturing. When I think about the concept behind our technology, I think about coffee. Coffee's a water-based liquid, and it's got stuff in it. It's also hot, but not boiling. And yet it creates this steam, this pure water vapor. We're going to do the same thing with wastewater. We're going to capture the water that's been evaporated off of it for drillers to use on site. Now, this is an evaporative process, and so we need heat. This is why hydraulic fracturing is a perfect application for it. Water, the wastewater that comes up from the wells has been geothermally heated and comes up at temperatures just below boiling. In addition, certain hydraulic fracturing sites around the U.S. flare off the natural gas, and we can use the energy from these flare-offs to heat the wastewater even further. Now, these two types of heat are waste heat. The heat energy was just going to be released to the environment, and now we can use it to purify water. Refrackt uses a vacuum membrane distillation system to capture this water vapor. We evaporate the water through a membrane, and we enhance this evaporation process with a vacuum. What's important to realize here is that with this membrane technology, we're really accelerating the evaporative process that would otherwise be fairly slow. With the membranes, we can create increased surface area and has, for example, we can have the evaporative power of 2 football fields full of coffee cups fitting inside 1 membrane module. That's a small footprint for a plant. When we attach the vacuum lines and draw water vapor out, we create even more water. We put these membrane modules into our semi-trailers, and we create our mobile water regeneration system. With this system, we designed it to create up to 90% water recovery. When we look at the competing technologies for water treatment, we see that Refrackt has lower energy usage and lower maintenance costs. Now is the time to commercialize vacuum membrane distillation treatment. For one thing, the cost to produce membranes is decreasing, which means that the cost to produce our system will decrease as well. Secondly, hydraulic fracturing has a great demand for wastewater treatment and has the available waste heat and a complex wastewater needs that we're uniquely situated to treat. Thirdly, existing water treatment companies are already tied to technologies that aren't suited for this application. They can't adapt as quickly, and they can't take on new technologies like the way that startups can. Now that I've talked about our technology, I'm going to pass it back to Dan to talk about the business plan.
Thanks, Judy. So here's a picture of business as usual. Right now, drillers ship tons of water into the site. That water gets injected downhole, and then a portion of it comes back up as wastewater. And that wastewater is then trucked offsite to either be disposed or treated. Refrackt brings our solution to the customer's site, cutting down the water consumption by allowing for reuse, and then also cutting transport costs, which can represent up to 84% of a driller's total handling costs for water. We're looking at a fee-for-services-based model of revenue. We anticipate $100 to $150 per 1,000 gallons of water treated based on current driller's willingness to pay, depending on the region. To reach these goals, we've set several milestones for ourselves. Within 6 months, we'll have a bench scale lab set up, and within 9, we'll be done with first round of performance testing. Then, through various iterations at different scale, we'll be ready for a full-size pilot in 2 years. The dollar amounts at the bottom of the screen represent cumulative costs for equipment, and we anticipate those being covered by funding from grants and prize money. For the pilot stage onwards, we'll be looking for VC money to cover our operating costs. Building off of our pilot's results as a foundation, we want to expand aggressively because right now is the right time. First, we'll aim for 1% market share, moving to 10 and then 30% in the areas where drillers are willing to pay for treatment. These revenues are based off of 1.4 annual revenue per mobile treatment system that we operate. Our team has strong backgrounds in energy, water, and membrane systems. In addition, our team and our business concept have attracted a high level of experience in technical, business, law, and policy skills for our advisory board. I want to leave you with 3 key takeaways. First, that there's an enormous unmet need for a wastewater solution in the fracking industry. Second, that we're competitive over the alternative wastewater treatment technologies because of our waste heat-driven process. And third, that since we're mobile, we'll be cutting the transport costs as well as cutting water consumption by these drillers. Thank you for your time, and I look forward to hearing your questions.
I've got a quick question. Another great job, guys. If you could go back to the CapEx, talk a little bit about CapEx, then talk, I'd like to hear a little bit about the political landscape with fracking. We all know that's a highly charged area right now as far as some of these communities. Also, I'd like to know a little bit more about what happens if the price of oil plunges, and what does that do to your business model?
So the price of oil right now is what's driving the development in certain areas like the Bakken. But even in the other ones, they're still required. Like, so a lot of these are sort of pay to play. They already bought the wells and they have to drill in order to recoup whatever capital costs they've already invested. So these drillers are stuck drilling no matter what. You might have seen that. It's been in the news a bunch in the Wall Street Journal and the New York Times. And in regards to the political landscape, it really depends on the region. So in Texas, they're less litigious. And in New York, they're having a lot of problems with that. But we see it coming down the line because it is really a huge benefit to the US's economy. And the states realize that. They just want to do it the right way. And that regulation will actually benefit us because it will make the drillers treat it instead of doing these other wastewater injection disposals.
What about the contractual process? So are you going to go basically work with an oil company, and obviously with the capital intensive nature of your business, I would hope or suspect that they're going to have to sign long-term contracts. Talk a little bit about the contractual process.
So actually right now, that is really what drives the wastewater industry. If you get in with the drillers and sign those contracts, then it's really a relationship building process. So that would be part of our plan in our pilot studies, to find a good partner in a region who's well respected by the other drillers.
So I read your business plan, and yep. You listed about 13 competitors, many of which already have some of which have a mobile solution in place today. Why exactly is this vacuum membrane technology something that you feel assured you're going to be first to market with, when many of your competitors are ahead of you in other aspects already?
Well, I don't think any of the other competitors that were listed were using vacuum membrane distillation. So
I think he was asking about the other technologies. So the other technologies, they're actually not really making in the market right now because they're not equipped to handle what Judy was talking about with the complex wastewater needs. That's actually what the solutions are and how they change. So some of them need sort of to be set to certain levels. For example, RO has to handle, they optimize it for a certain salt content, but the salt content can switch between different wells and different geologies. So ours handles those fluctuations better.
I've got two questions. One is, have you done this before? And tied to that, is there enough wastewater, enough waste heat to boil all the water needed in order to create, to do what you're doing? And then my second question is around your model. Why did you choose to, why a service model as opposed to creating a product that you just sell to these companies? Is it that complicated, or is there another reason?
Okay, in terms of why we didn't want to sell the systems, is because we didn't really want to get tied down to basically manufacturing the systems. We wanted to go out and develop the relationships with the drillers and have a few systems on the ground that could treat a bunch of different wells at a time. Did you want to talk about the other question?
Yeah, first about one? The amount of heat available. Well, that's one of the things that we're looking at, and we arrange our system to and accordingly with the different temperatures that come out of the different wastewaters.
Have you done this before?
No, there are not a lot of vacuum membrane distillation companies out there for me to have gotten experience with. But I will be looking to get that experience very soon.
So my question about the membrane, right? No one else is doing that today. Is it done in the lab? I mean, is this like kind of early stage stuff, and how long until it actually works? And then is there IP?
Yes, I'm working on it in the lab. Sorry, I'm not as fluent as Dan is sometimes. Yes, we're working on it in the lab. My lab has a strong history of working on this same technology. And so we've been developing larger scale prototypes, but we're just still at the lab scale right now.
So to that question, is that why it's going to take 2 years? Because you're still building it out? Because
yeah,
as a software guy, like 2 years sounds like freaking forever. Like, I wouldn't wait that long.
Yeah, as you can see for our system, we want to test it in the lab. We want to have this mid-size level testing just to make sure we get everything right before we develop our full-scale prototype and bring it out for field testing. We want to make sure we've got a good product.
In fact, one of our business advisors, we had a longer R&D timescale, and then he said, what would you do if you had the ability for unlimited capital? and how quickly could you get it out? So that's sort of where we're going from.
So I'll pile onto that question. If you had unlimited capital, what's your biggest challenge?
It's building those relationships with the drillers and getting out there. It's really sort of, since it is relationship-based, they trust you once they know you, but we have to get out, and we're starting to do that this summer. We already have, there's a bunch of researchers, and one of the other students at the Nick School actually did their MP working with drillers, and so he's going to start getting us samples, and we're going to start making connections.
We'll take one more question.
Well, can I pick up on that? So you don't really look like an oil well drilling guy, right? So
you haven't seen me. You haven't seen me outside of the pitch.
So
we can hire one.
isn't your product going to deliver the relationship? I mean, you heard David talk about like what their solutions did. They allowed their customers to do their jobs in a much, much better way. If vacuum membrane distillation really works and gives you clean water after, based on that radioactive brine that you're pumping out, like, who cares about the relationship?
So it is, we have to, I think that it's also tied into that there's sort of a suspicious bunch. They won't believe that until they see it, so that's where the partnerships come in, with showing it and expanding. And in terms of, it is very much so that if we deliver, then it will start to grow, and that's why the initial market share is one and then growing up.
And just to follow up on that.
Time is up.
I hope you guys do well.
Anyway, yeah. I have experience working in water treatment. Thank you to Refrackt. We're now going to hear from our last finalist, Refresh Innovation.
Hi. My name is Matt Pleatman, and I'm a senior here at Duke University in the Pratt School of Engineering. I quickly wanted to say thank you to everyone in the Duke entrepreneurial community. We actually competed in the Startup Challenge last year, and we had little more than an idea and a lot to learn. So thank you all so much. You've been really supportive over the last year. I'm really excited to be here to show you a revolution in personal eye care health, the contact lens refresh card. But let me quickly tell you about my team. We're a combination of Duke Engineering, Stanford Business, and the Triangle's best biomedical product design firm out there. And we're honored to have an outstanding board of advisors. We have the industry's top regulatory experts, eye doctors, and medical device entrepreneurs informing our strategy. We're thrilled to have them with us. Now, I want you to imagine for a moment you're a contact lens wearer, like me, and you're traveling. But you've forgotten your case again. So you end up sleeping in your lenses, only to hate yourself the next morning, because your eyes are incredibly dry and uncomfortable. Or maybe you're on a bike ride, and something gets in your eye. But you don't have your big bottle of solution with you to clean off your lenses. These are the kinds of problems we heard from 425 users, from 425 user interviews over and over again. Yet, if you take a look at the products that are on the market today, you find none of them are designed for your daily life. They're all too bulky and inconvenient. That's why I'm thrilled to introduce the Contact Lens Refresh Card. It's the first product of its kind that lets you refresh, store, and disinfect your contact lenses anytime, anywhere.
What is Refresh Now, you ask? Tell you. Refresh Now is an all-in-one contact lens case and multi-purpose solution package. Fits in your wallet. As a lens case on one side, pops out, store your lenses overnight, and two multi-purpose solution drops on the other. Use these to clean my lenses, to rewear my eyes, store the case overnight.
A scary fact is that 80% of all the eye infections that contact lens wearers get every year can be traced back to their misuse. But what nobody understands right now, what everyone's missing, is that the only way to get contact lens wearers to care for their lenses properly is to make it simple and easy to do. But nothing else out there does that. Well, guess what? The Refresh Card does exactly that. What you saw in the video was just an early prototype. Since then, we've done 24 design iterations to arrive at what you see here. This is the design we'll be using for our alpha production run. And it's worth noting, we have patent-pending features relating to safety, ease of use, and durability. We designed the refresh card so that it has 4 times as much solution as you would ever need to fill the case. And an 800-pound man could literally sit on this thing without it ever leaking. Our legal team did a comprehensive prior art search. And these are just a few of the claims. We made 32 claims in our provisional patent application. You can see a few of them here. Now, it's a great product, but do people really want to use this thing? We knew the real test was to see if you could take a potential user and turn them into an actual paying customer. So, inspired by the Kickstarter model, we ran our own offline crowdfunding campaign with a goal of selling 1,000 units. And we were able to achieve that in just a matter of hours. And in the process, we learned a ton about our customers. The average price they'd be willing to pay for a refresh card is $3. And they'd use one every 6 to 7 weeks. And it only costs less than 30 cents to manufacture a refresh card at scale. So we're looking at some really attractive margins. Now, there are a lot of numbers on this slide, but what I want you to take away is that in 2012, there were 147 million contact lens wearers worldwide, and they're projected to spend almost $12 billion by 2016. That implies a total addressable market for the refresh card of $2.9 billion. To get the refresh card to market, we initiated discussions with all the manufacturing and distribution partners you see here. And they've gone really well. We did them under non-compete agreements. And in fact, over the last few months, we've had several acquisition offers, but we opted to go for partnerships because our team, after discussing, we decided we wanted to share in the upside in a product that we truly believe in. Our distribution strategy is as unique as the product itself. Expect to see the refresh card everywhere. Hotels, cruise lines, airports, doctor's offices, and even vending machines. But don't forget, there's a huge opportunity to let other companies brand their own refresh cards. Imagine the 1-800-CONTACTS brand living with its customer in their wallet, purses, and glove box. And next time they're in a bind, or they're thinking about reordering contact lenses, their brand is right there waiting for them. Now, here you can see a high-level roadmap for refresh innovations over the next 12 months, which goes all the way from our alpha production run to our first large-scale production run. But what I want to focus on is where the Duke Startup Challenge comes in over the next 3 to 6 months. With the $50,000 from the Duke Startup Challenge, we would be able to take our company to the next level. We'd be able to finalize our partnerships with manufacturing and distribution with legal help, go through our entire alpha production run, convert our provisional patent applications into full applications, and file our regulatory documents. It would be a real game changer. And, you know, in summary, we have the team. We have the intellectual property. We have minimal regulatory requirements. And we have the passion. The Duke Startup Challenge Capital will be the rocket fuel we need to get the refresh card to market and into your hands. And remember, life is unpredictable. Be prepared with a refresh card. Thanks so much for your time.
Good job. Couple of questions. One on you showed the monies you'd use from the startup challenge, but you'll need a lot more than that, right? So, do you know how much you need overall to?
So, the really exciting thing for us is that we actually need a very small amount of capital to reach some valuation inflection points, and it was really interesting in the process of looking for engineering partners to actually design the product, looking for manufacturers. We came to them with a proposition, and they came back with us so interested in our product that they wanted something on the next level. So let me give you an example. the product design firm that we partner with to actually do the design for manufacturability, we just wanted to pay them to do the work. They loved the product so much that they actually invested in us and became partners. Originally, we went to the eye care companies just to ask about buying solution from them for our own manufacturing purposes. But they loved the product so much that they wanted to partner with us to bring the Refrackt card to market. So our business strategy does involve a licensing component, and we need a really small amount of capital to reach a few more valuation inflection points.
Yeah, well, I think your costs are a little low on the 510K and then your patent filing. That's for one, right? So it doesn't include the...
Our provisional patent actually already includes claims. Mm-hmm. So we have a really small cost to convert those. And the regulatory filing is a designation request. So it's actually a really small cost.
Yeah, and then you've got to do multiple countries of the with your IP.
Yeah.
So the other thing, too, when you were with the market size, yes, it's huge, and I'm a contact lens wearer, mm-hmm. but I wear the disposable ones.
Right.
So I don't have any need to put them in a case.
Yes.
So
if you the core market is 83%,
uh-huh.
and we've actually totally excluded the daily disposable users,
okay.
even though in our interviews mm-hmm. we found that 60% of them actually would buy the Refrackt card. So even intraday contact lens wearers have use cases for it.
Okay.
But we thought about that a lot, and that's why we're very conservative actually in this number.
Okay.
So you keep saying you don't need much capital, but how much do you need?
I'll show you. So, okay.
You had good answers to all the other questions.
So, part of it is our product design firm is invested in us. So that $31,000 doesn't reflect all the costs that are encompassed by that, because part of it is eaten by our partnership. And we have, we've been entirely self-funded up to this point. So we actually are willing. We'll potentially spend more money as well.
You need an answer to that question. So my other comment, and I've had investors say something like this to me before, and I thought, you're a moron, but you said you could reduce infection rates by 80%, right? 80% of infections are caused by misuse.
That's
so,
right.
But you're getting $3. How much does it cost to treat an infection?
So I think typically you're treating an infection with antibacterials. So. I'm not a doctor, or a pharmacist, so I won't tell you.
Because it just seems like there's a lot more opportunity in preventing infection than.
I'm really glad you brought that up. If you go to all the medical device manufacturers and you ask them what their priority is, they'll say, safety, safety, safety. We're all about safety. But the problem is, to actually achieve safety, you have to give people a product that enables them to practice safe behaviors. Well, to do the best practices in their contact lens routine without changing their behavior. So you put this in your wallet and forget about it. It's there when you need it. You would not believe some of the stories we've heard. People putting lenses in their mouth to clean them. We've heard stories of storing contact lenses in a cup of water at their hotel because they didn't have a case, only to drink them the next morning.
So I'm gonna give it another try. When you say invested in, does that mean that they have invested dollars, or is there an economic, license or royalties or prepays? I mean, what do you mean by an investment in?
So you want to know the specifics of our arrangement?
I guess the economic terms of quote unquote the investment.
Okay, so we issued them convertible debt and also paid them cash.
For your distribution, are you looking more to partner with people like Bausch & Lomb and Walmart, or to get out your own brand and sell it that way? And how are they going to feel if you're double selling it?
So we're interested in both. So we definitely think our manufacturing partners are going to want to use their traditional distribution routes, but our business model is to let them do that, while also developing our own brand and potentially letting other companies brand their own Refrackt cards as well, like 1-800-CONTACTS. And we've actually had conversations with all the companies that were on that slide and more. And they're all over this product.
So one quick comment. So I love the customer development, the fact that you had a bunch of statistics there that you got out of the building and talked to customers. That's really important. I have 20 years. This is the only industry that we talked about today that I have experience in. So I have 20 years of contacts and glasses wear. It's a real trialability market. So I basically took the recommendations of my optometrist every time, right? Like try these new contacts or try this new solution. In some ways, they're as much your customer as the contact wearer. How do you get to them?
So what's really interesting about this product is if you look at the partners that we're that we've been talking with, just Alcon, for instance, they have over 50% of the solution market. So if we entered a manufacturing partnership with them, for instance, or any one of these players, they have a big chunk of the market. So they could literally decide to include a refresh card with every box of solution they sell or every box of contacts they sell. So that's one route. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. No, it's good.
We're out of time. Sorry.
So I'd go back to my comment about needing to say how much money you need to raise, because if you got to market this thing, you need a marketing budget. It's going to be bigger than sounds like your any other budget that you have.
Right. And
sorry, we are out of time. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you to all the finalists. We're actually going to bring up all the finalists again on stage, so if all of you will join me. So to face the judges? Sorry. Yeah. We're going to do a group Q&A and feedback session, so I'd actually want to let each judge just ask one question, offer one piece of feedback if we just want to go down the line. Or whoever wants to go first.
I'll ask a question. Same question to all of you. Why are you doing this? Why are you doing what you're doing?
I guess I chose first in line.
Sorry. Question is why are you doing what you decided to do?
I don't know if you guys noticed my passion, but I definitely want a safe sight. Glaucoma is a devastating disease. It affects a lot of people, and this was something I started with my dad, and this is a legacy for me. I named it Camras Vision after he passed away. I mean, my heart's in it. I'm gonna take it all away, and this technology could change, like, it could stop pressure being an issue in glaucoma. I mean, it's huge, so there's no doubt in my passion. Go ahead.
So I've been a businessman ever since I can remember. I could tell you an anecdote. When I was in sixth grade, I was a good student, and anyone who did their homework on time got free homework passes so they could, you know, get out of the next assignment. Well, I thought, I wonder if other people value these more than I do, maybe. So I created a market for homework passes and started selling them to my classmates. Unfortunately, I couldn't foresee that maybe those students weren't expecting to get them, and the teacher knew that too, but that comes with experience, right? But I love entrepreneurship. I started a media studio when I was 12 years old doing photography and videography, and it's just the most fun you can possibly have. I love starting businesses.
For me, I'll talk about the technology aspect and working at industrial facilities, right? The thing that they hammer home most is we gotta reduce water usage, we gotta reduce energy usage, you know, go to zero wastewater discharge. And so for that, me, like, it was really cool to see industrial companies really valuing that and working towards that myself. And I just wanted to say, like, yes, I wear steel-toe shoes. You know, yes, I work in the yard. You know, please don't think that I don't have that experience.
For me, everybody says global warming's really our generation's issue, but that really boils down for me to the energy water nexus. And that's why I came back to school, to look for an area where we provide value while also bettering the environment and the people who live in it. And what better product to create than fresh water?
Yeah, like Dan, I'm a student of water resources management. And to me, the most important thing is clean and reliable water. And before coming here to Duke, I was pretty skeptical of hydraulic fracturing. But then I started working with Dan and Judy and Victor, and realize that we're kind of at the ground level of a big opportunity to do this valuable process right and to maintain clean water. So that's why I'm into it. It's just a phenomenal opportunity to do a lot of good.
Yeah, building on what Dan and Mark just said,
hydraulic fracturing is a huge thing. There are 950 wells being drilled each month, and that's a ton of wastewater. And I mean, there's no real good solution to that. So it just seemed like something that we could do to help.
Why will your business fail?
Well, I don't know if you can hear me. The hope is obvious that it wouldn't, but the big hurdle that we face is regulatory. That's no doubt.
The question was, why would your business fail? I guess just like any consumer product, you know, we've done the best job we possibly can to de-risk the market side, but until that product is actually on the shelf somewhere and you start to see people buying it, I mean, there's no way you can fully de-risk that. So I'd say that's the biggest risk.
My business won't fail. I'll let Dan answer this question.
So I think it's anything with like hardware. You basically have huge capital investments that are necessary, and you need to show your investors that they're going to get a return on investment. But with clean energy tech in particular, it's not like the internet startups where you're going to get returns really quickly. It's a much longer payout period, but you're also changing much larger markets potentially. But it's hard to find that capital right now and raise that.
And to add to what Dan said, we have a great technology, and I think it's a real big breakthrough, but this is becoming more of a service-driven industry, and I think that will be a challenge, forming those relationships that Dan talked about earlier. So that will be a barrier to us, but I'm confident we can pass that barrier.
I guess one scenario I could think of where we would fail, which I regard as highly implausible, is if all regulation of hydraulic fracturing was just thrown aside, but that's probably never going to happen, so...
I'm sorry, for the next time, just...
Yeah, one
person, thank you. Great.
You got that.
Any more comments or questions from the judges?
Okay. Real quick, when I think about startups, I think about three things: capital, customer, and talent. Uh-huh. We didn't talk about talent tonight. Obviously, you guys as founders are done a phenomenal job. Talk about your approach to building out teams.
Yeah, so one of the things that I had mentioned is that stage two to stage three, we need a CEO, we need to hire a lot more people. I mean, it's not going to be just me and my business partner, Roberto, handling it all. I mean, we have a lot of passion and we do have some experience, but we will work with people who know it even better. And I think that will be really incremental for our success, because we can't be naive and this is too important of a problem to think that we can take it on all by ourselves.
So I think one of the strongest parts of Refrackt Innovations is our team. I'm honored to work with my partners, Colin and Anish. They're both MBAs at Stanford right now in their second year. And we also have Ted Mosler, who is also the president of Galera Biomedical on our product side. He has over 30 patents. And you saw our slide. We have an outstanding board of advisors, the best eye doctors from Harvard, Stanford. We have a medical device entrepreneur from Genentech on our advisory board. Our team is really stacked.
So everybody's been hammering home the team aspect. The way our company actually started was Victor, Mark, and I have been sitting in class the last year, and before that we've been thinking about it. We have this huge problem. We hear about the policies, the economics behind it, everything driving the problem, but what's the solution? Judy's working on the solution. So she comes in doing research in her lab, focused on this one technology, but you need to find applications. We've been leaning really heavily also for the business skill side on our advisory board, including David Doctor, who's in the audience, who has a lot of startup experience, and Yesko, who I don't think is here tonight, but those advisors have helped us out a lot on that end, but it's really everything together.
Okay, that's all we have time for, thank you. Apologize, we're running a little late on time. Thank you. Okay. Janet will lead the finalists off stage.
Okay.
And I'm going to direct you judges off stage. The judges will now be making their deliberations to vote for their favorite team.
While the judges deliberate, don't go anywhere, because now it's time for you guys to vote. Oh, okay. So this is really important, because in the case of a tie, it's the audience vote, your vote, that will break the tie. So I hope you remember to bring your phones, and this is how it's going to work. In the next slide, I'll show you three numbers, each corresponding to one of the finalist teams. And what you want to do is text the code that corresponding to the team that you want to vote for to 37607, or whatever the number is. So for example, if I want to vote for Team Red, I'll be texting 72612 to the number 37607. You got that? All right. Okay, so the polls are gonna start now. Okay, so we're going to close the polls now. Are the polls closed? All right. Music? Okay. Can we go fish shopping? What? We're gonna be getting out threads. most of you got a shirt, maybe? Awesome. Go ahead and get everyone's attention. All right. Now it's time for us to do our raffle of the night. Hey, so get your tickets out. We're going to be raffling off this iPad mini. All right, Jana has a basket. Do you want to pick? Oh, okay. She'll pick a number. Okay. 816170. Come on up. All right, come on up.
Are you?
Oh. Yeah, come on down. Okay, what's your name?
Mandri.
Yes. Awesome. Thank you. Yeah. Congratulations, Mandri, for winning the iPad mini. Awesome. So, as the judges continue to deliberate, we have one more speaker for you here tonight. I'm really honored to introduce Dr. Eric Toon, who is a newly appointed director of the Innovation and Entrepreneurship Initiative here at Duke. Eric has been a person of many hats. He's a very committed educator, having taught at Duke for the past 20 years as a professor of chemistry. He's also an inventor with more than 20 patents in his name. He's also an entrepreneur. He started two medical startups as the scientific founder. And in addition to that, right before coming back here to Duke, he was in the Department of Energy, where he built up the ARPA-E initiative from the ground up, where he worked to disperse millions of dollars to energy technology programs at ARPA-E. And he's decided to come back to Duke to join the Innovation and Entrepreneurship Initiative in order to cultivate and continue to build entrepreneurship at Duke. So we welcome Eric. Thank you for being here.
Thank you very much. That was an awful lot of fun, I have to say. An incredible group of competitors, not just the finalists and the winners that were with us here tonight, but all of the competitors through the entire competition. Really inspiring.
The first thing that I'd really like to do is to take just a moment to recognize Howie, to thank Howie. Howie's been... Howie spends an enormous amount of time at this startup challenge and does a tremendous service to this university. So while our judges are deliberating, Howie asked me to just take a couple of minutes to talk to you about our vision for innovation and entrepreneurship and how we plan to start building it out. So as you heard, a year ago, I had been away from the university for almost 3 years. I stepped away from Duke in the spring of 2009, and I was thinking about what to do next. And I talked to a number of people at Duke about what I might do if I was to come back here. And one of the things that we kept coming back to was the new Innovation and Entrepreneurship Initiative that had really been started by Kimberly Jenkins, who stepped away from the board to do something, to really follow her heart and to do something that she believed in. But I think before you get involved with something like this, something that you're really going to throw yourself at, it's important to take a little time to think about why this is an important thing to do. Why is innovation and entrepreneurship an important thing to do at a university? And I'll tell you, the more I thought about it, the more I realized that in the time that I've been away from Duke, the world really shifted under my feet, and shifted under the feet of the university. Think about the educational mission of the university today. In 2012, at that time, 2013 now. You know, there's $1 trillion of student debt in this country. $1 trillion, that's an astonishing number. The national debt is $16.5 trillion. There's $1 trillion of student debt in this country. I don't know where the massive open online course movement is going, but I promise you that it's going somewhere. And one has to question the business model of charging kids $60,000 a year to go to school going forward. At the same time, spending time in Washington, spending time on the Hill, I got a chance to look close up at what it means to make difficult decisions about how to allocate scarce resources among way, way, way more needs than there are resources to go around. And you realize that the research mission of the university is also in a precarious place as our Congress decides how to allocate those resources. And it suddenly became incredibly clear to me exactly why Duke and every other university needs an innovation and an entrepreneurship initiative. And it's because for the 21st century, the university needs to be a different place. We need a different business model. The university needs to have a different relationship with society. And at bottom then, the innovation and entrepreneurship initiative that we're building here at Duke aims to redefine the university, to change the university, to build a new university for the 21st century. Take a university, a model that has existed primarily for the creation of knowledge and also the dissemination of knowledge, and to turn the university into a place that sees as a fundamental part of its core mission the translation of that knowledge into real things and real actions that make a real difference to real people's lives. And so that at bottom for me is what the Innovation and Entrepreneurship Initiative is about. It's about making the university relevant for the 21st century. It's about making clear to the people who pay the bills why it's important for us to have their money and to use their money, what our value proposition is. So how will we do that? How will we build this here at Duke then going forward? And the plan really is to build the initiative around four fundamental thrusts or pillars. The first of those thrusts is education. The education part of the initiative will be a soup to nuts thing, experiential and didactic from undergraduates to alumni and everything in between. It'll be how-to kinds of things. It'll be theoretical kinds of things. It'll be lots and lots heavy on the experiential part. For instance, the Duke and Silicon Valley program that we're running this year. Matt and Clay Christensen teaching a course on the Apple campus, right? An incredible opportunity being run through Duke Global Ed, 4-credit course that's being offered for the first time this year. It's internship programs, it's InCube, it's DoHatch, it's all of those sorts of things, and we'll expand those programs and make them deeper and richer and more impactful. So education will be our first thrust. Research, fundamental research in entrepreneurship, trying to understand what the real sort of secret sauce is, how you enable and encourage entrepreneurship, both on the university and in society more broadly. It'll be about thinking about new ways to protect intellectual property going forward in a first-to-file universe. It'll be about new models of finance to enable the sorts of translation we're talking about.
The third fundamental thrust of the initiative will be translation. It will be providing to the university community all of the tools that they need to put their ideas into action. Money, space, expertise, help, all of those sorts of things. And the fourth thrust of the initiative, I think you could argue, is already woven through the other three, but it's important enough that we'll stand it out on its own, and that's social entrepreneurship. And we'll do social entrepreneurship first and foremost because I think it's important for the university to do. If you're not going to do social entrepreneurship at the university, where are you going to do it? And we'll do social entrepreneurship as well because Duke already has tremendous strengths in that area with Greg Bees and Matt Nash and Case here at Duke with Tony Brown and many others. So I look forward to building this initiative and working with all of you going forward. And now I think is the time that you've really been waiting for, and I see the judges are ready to come back. So we'll welcome them back to the stage.
So as the judges take their seats back on stage, we'd just like to say a couple quick thank yous. So thank you so much to everyone who has helped out with the Duke Startup Challenge. I know that there are some of you who flew in and were judging remotely, so I just want to take a moment to recognize everyone in the audience who has helped out. And also, we want to say a big thank you to Howie Ree, our advisor. Howie has worked tirelessly over the past year, sending emails to judges and competitors, and he's really the person behind this whole thing and making it all come together. So thank you, Howie. We also want to thank our sponsors for the year, and they are 99 Designs, Clear Sketch, The Chronicle, Groundwork Labs, Eye Contact, Jimmy John's, The Mountain Company, and Sheriff Isle. And also a big thank you to our individual donors, Rich Lee, Peter Fox, Jack Egan, and Hap Espenshade. Their contribution has helped tremendously to make this competition possible. So if there's any of you in the audience who like the show tonight, who think that you have an idea that could become a company, this could be you upstage on stage next year. So the Duke Startup Challenge competition, the early deadline is in October, and our final deadline is in January. So if you just check us out on the web at www.dukestartupchallenge.org, you can find out more information. And of course, after following the announcement of the winner, join us immediately afterwards for networking and refreshments outside. Great. David, what was that like? What was the judges' deliberation like? Do you have any, you know, last comments before we announce?
So it was great. For each of the different finalists, we had a few different thoughts. So first, for the Camras one, we really liked the market opportunity, the passion, the progress that the entrepreneur had made, the fact that they'd already had some SBIR grants and other grants. And so really, really promising venture. For Refrackt, we thought it was a really big market opportunity. We could see the pain that they were trying to solve and the opportunity in the market. And then for the Refresh, really impressive idea, really liked the ability to get to market quickly. And so overall, we were very, very impressed by the three finalists.
Thank you, David. So we'll invite the finalists back onto stage. So this is the moment that you've all been waiting for. I've got the name of the winner of the $50,000 grand prize in my hand, and I'd like to ask him to do the honors.
And the winner is Refrackt Innovation.
Looking.
All right, thank you everyone for coming. Remember, join us outside for networking and refreshments. Have a good evening.
Produced by Duke University, online at duke.edu.